we protect children online? You know, because obviously the cyberbullying is a problem, but there's also not much censorship online, so they've got access to pretty much anything, whether they're searching for it or not. And obviously, we know the big ones to avoid is porn and violence. But there's also websites encouraging people to commit suicide or how to be anorexic. So how can we protect children online?
Well, the protection is only going to be partial, and that's an upsetting fact to recognize.
Yeah.
That as much as we love our children and want to protect them, it's everywhere. And even if you were to have the most impeccable, exhaustive controls at home, so that not an ounce of negativity from the online world crept in, there could be somebody else's house. So it's not just about protecting, it's also about preparing them and strengthening them so that they can handle what they will see and hear, and also so that they feel comfortable coming to the parent to talk about it. But a lot of times, even in very loving families, the child or young person doesn't feel comfortable coming to the parent because the parent often will feel shocked or might even reprimand the child.
Yeah. Okay.
And you can see why an upset parent would do that, but the effect is to make the young person think, well, I'm never going to talk to them again about anything serious. So one of the ways to help a young person to feel comfortable talking about the things that bother them is for parents to not appear shocked, even if they are shocked. And they meant, well, it might be because they didn't grow up in this world, but to not appear shocked. And there's a particular strategy that I teach that's called reflective listening. I didn't invent it. Many of the strategies that I teach I didn't invent, I just garnered them from a number of different places. And reflective listening is a way of responding when our children, or when anybody, is upset.
Yeah.
Or when we just get the sense that they're upset. And instead of questioning them, which often makes them feel like they're put on the spot and they have to come up with the right answer, instead of giving them a lecture about how they shouldn't have been there doing that in the first place, or how they shouldn't be feeling so vulnerable, I mean, none of that's going to work. Reflective listening is about imagining how the young person is feeling and reflecting that back in words. And that's such a simple thing to do that you might think it would be easy, but it actually isn't so easy to do because parents don't want their child to feel upset. We love our children and we want them to feel good. So when they are feeling upset, or when we just suspect that they are, there's a very strong tendency to somehow try and take that away from them.
Yeah.
For their sake and actually for our sake as well, because it's uncomfortable for us to think that our darling is upset. But we have to practice accepting that in everybody's life, there's going to be plenty of upset. In our own, there is, and in our children's, there will be as well. And by listening and attempting to understand what they're feeling, that can give children and teenagers a very comforting feeling that they're not alone with this, that they don't have to act altogether. And that's the beginning of being able to talk about this.